this one that we have this net data type. Actually, basically, there are two data types. One is a net data type, the other is a register data type. In 1995, this was the name for this data type. Among data types, this was the one, registers is the one. But in the year 2001, language has got several amendments changes. They renamed these registers to variable data type, just to avoid the confusion between this reg here. If you see this reg is a part of this register data type. And also to avoid the confusion that this register sometimes may mean to our flip-flop, group of flip-flops. So that sort of confusion to avoid, the document says that to avoid such confusion, they renamed this register type to variable type. So we should be familiar now that if we are going to any interview or anywhere, that this data types are two types, basically net and the other is a variable data type. So this net data type has got default value Z. Suppose I am declaring any net data type. These are the keywords here. We have wire one, T-R-I, try, and there is a W-O-R, war, and this is T-R-I-O-R, trior, like that. So here we have this wired or net. This is going to function like wired or logic. This wired or logic, I don't know how many of you are familiar with. So if we go here, this I'm not understanding how to come out of this laser. Just want to come out of this laser. I think the highlighter is there. So let me escape. If I press, I am coming out of that laser pointer. So this wide or is something like this. So with this here, let me take that again, that what is that pointer, laser pointer. So this here, if you see, this is A, B, C, D, and there is an inverter. Before coming to this buffer itself, we are inverting the signal. That's why this is called here, negative AND. This is, if you see this one, everything here. I don't know whether visible. Can someone confirm this here? A bar, B bar, C bar, D bar. Is it visible? Can someone confirm this? Suresh?
Sir, it is visible.
Yeah,
yes,
thank you.
You can
visible. Yeah, thank you. So here we have this A and a bar. This is the bar, and then similarly B bar. So since we are just before, even before coming to this, what is expected actually, this is something like an inverter. So this is not having an inverter. First inverter symbol is this tilted triangle, and then here is a bubble. But if you see this one here, even before this tilted triangle, we had a bubble here. So this is something, a negative AND operation with inverters. So this is, and moreover, one more term here, terminology is a open collector. If you see this figure carefully, you see this transistor collector is connected to 5 volts here. Transistor, this is connected to 5 volts here. And this one emitter is connected to the ground. Suppose say here we are through this buffer, if we make the signal high here, and this high is coming here, enough voltage is available for this, biasing voltage is been provided here, then this transistor will conduct. When this transistor is conducting, this entire thing is actually grounded here. So that way, what we are doing is, this is becoming a zero here. At the output side, it is becoming a low. So this sort of arrangement is called open collector wired negative AND operation with inverters. In this case, here two configurations are there. You see, I will read out for you. I think this is not visible to everyone. When one or more output transistors, when one or more, here are the transistors, one or more transistors, when one or more output transistors are on, the output is low. If one is on or more are also on, then this is low. But here the case is different. When all output transistors are off, when all output transistors are off, no one is conducting here, no one is conducting here, at that time this output is high. It is very much evident from this why it is low. Why it is low? Just because here is conducting and this is going to the ground. So this output here is actually connected to the ground. Just because this transistor is connected to the ground and this wire here, the output that you are trying to observe is actually is grounded here, just because this transistor is on. So likewise, the same thing here is presented here. This is called a wired AND. This is also a wired AND. Why we are calling this one negative AND? The reason is, even before inverting here, we are actually, the signal is inverted here. So that's why it's a negative AND operation. This is negative AND operation. So with this slide, what we actually I'm trying hard is just to tell this open collector, if there are several input signals, one is high, the other is low, maybe the other is high, something like that. So how this open collector is going to play a role to identify or to decide the output? This configuration is called open collector configuration, where all are inverters here. This entire thing is an inverter. All are connected to the single wire here. So on what basis this output is decided then? Because this inverter may have output 1, this inverter may have output 0, this inverter may have output again 1 or 0. So meaning, on this single output line here, we have 1, 0, different outputs are there, different, not same outputs. So in such case, on what basis we have to decide the output, this output? That is defined, dictated by this open collector configuration. So that is the advantage this open collector is facilitating. When one or more devices are connected to a single line, at that time, how do you define your output? So there should be some means in electronics. Electronics means maybe one or maybe zero. It cannot be something else. So we have to define this. This scenario is coming into the picture in real life. So in such case, this is how we make it possible, a meaningful output. And this sort of mechanism to make output meaningful is called open collector wired logic. So that open this physically what these devices are there. So that is what here this one, in this case here, this these are playing the role like that. So wired OR is there, wired AND is there. So those slides are there what I have shown. So these are in a language, they are imitated with the keywords, this WOR and WAND. So WAND and OR like that. This is for wired OR logic or wired AND logic. So at this point, if not clear, you don't need to go panic. We will take up some examples to and we'll work out at that time. Lot more things you will experience practically. In a better way, you will understand. So you don't go panic at this point. So now coming to the tri-OR here. We have some signals here, our devices, something like, I will just take the paint help here, so that I can present what we are meaning, try means. So if you take this one here, you have something like this. You know this is inverter, and you have something like this. You know, this is a buffer. So, but you want to have it a conditionally. A condition should meet, then only it should work. A buffer, you are giving some input and it is giving a same in here after some delay. After some delay, this output means in only, but after some delay. In some design cases, we need some delay. So that delay is obtained using the buffers. So this is inverter. So this inverter, if you are giving here in, you know that it is IN bar. So, but you want to have a conditional output here. So this conditional output may come with this additional input to this inverter device. Similarly to this buffer also, it will come like that. So now this condition can be of two types. Another inverter, if you take, this condition could be like this. And another buffer, if you take, that condition could be like this. So if you notice here, this buffer, small circle, is stating that if this is one, then directly this will work. This inverter is actually giving this one when this is one. Here it should be zero. When this is zero, then this is inverted and this is becoming one here, and then whatever IN is there, that will be working here like a IN bar. So meaning, basically what I'm trying to convey with this is, these are tri-state gates. Like that we have them, we want to have it in our Verilog HDL, not if zero. This is not, you have to not, I mean invert, if zero, condition is zero. Likewise, we have not if one, meaning this one. So likewise, buff if zero, buffer if zero. So that is why they are data types. So this nature we have to be able to model in the language, in a English like language, in the Verilog HDL we have to model. And coming to this VDD, into this ground, we have to have some language constructs which helps us. This is a high voltage and this is a low voltage. So those are again achieved with the help of this you have this supply 1 and supply 0. So this supply 0, anything that you, this is a keyword, supply 0 is a part of a data type, and this data type name is net type. And here anything that you write, suppose say you're writing something BCD, supply 0, BCD. Actually that BCD is now working like a ground. Anywhere in your program definition, like this program definition here, this is the inverter program. Inverter program, if you see, this PMOS, is connected one end to the VDD. So this VDD here, in this case, we are calling it as a PWR. This PWR, this supply one is the keyword. This supply one is the keyword. And this is a data type, and this data type belongs to net data type. And here we have the identifier PWR. This PWR actually meaning the supply one. Supply one means actually it's a VDD. That's why here somewhere in the PMOS only you will see there is a VDD. So that's how this supply zero in NMOS case we are grounding. One end is grounded. So this is a user defined identifier, and this is a data type which is helping you to define your ground, your VDD. So that way this data types are helpful for us. So we must know as a Verilog writers. So this supply one, supply zero, likewise all these data types are essential. And coming to the final one here, this is y, and if you write this variable, user defined identifier reset, is a 1 bit wire. It is 1 bit wire. Default is one bit. See here, default here is a 1 bit. But if your wire has got several lines in that, wires in it. So like this data bus has got, suppose say, eight wires, vector type it is. So this vector type is stated like that. This is a square bracket. And you have this size defined here, the upper limit and the lower limit. And between colon is placed. So this is how you declare if there is a vector type. So if we don't declare vector type, and simply if you write that dbus, then dbus is treated like a 1 bit wire. So that's how the declaration part is carried in the net data type. Now, similar to this net data type, we have this register data type. Earlier, I was telling that register data type name is changed to variable data type. This variable data type has got this reg, integer, time, real time. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So these 5 are the subtypes in the variable data type. In most of the code writing applications, we use this reg to declare the variables, and this integer we use in loop, index variable for loops, for loop like that. So in that case, integer I like that we use for index variables. Time, most of the time for synthesis, RTL code means a code, anything that is synthesizable. A code, anything that is synthesizable means what? A code, anything that is synthesizable means it should give us a netlist. Yesterday we talked a lot about netlist, gate level netlist. It should give us a gate level netlist. Yesterday we also talked about all the language constructs are not supported by the synthesizer. So this reg is supported and integer is supported. Time may not be supported by the synthesizer tool. In that case, in your RTL, the actual design that you are describing in the using Verilog HDL, you cannot use that time. Then where time is used then? Time is used in simulations. We write the test benches. There where we use the time. Coming to the real, so we were talking about yesterday something like these values, 7.2 like that. If there are some constants like this, then we have to have this type of data type to handle such constants. So again, I am making a point here. Please note, if we are using Cadence RTL compiler, this RTL compiler renamed nowadays, and the name is Genus. The tool name is Genus. So we have to consult the tool document whether real this Verilog construct is supported for synthesis or not. So suppose a Cadence Genus tool, earlier Genus was called RTL compiler. If this Genus is supporting this real, it is not necessary that your Synopsys company design compiler should support this real. So be alert, if you are using any tool, first we have to refer that tool document which constructs are supported by the synthesizer. So general rule, these are supported by every tool, reg, integer. These are supported because this is a loop. For most of the times we use for loop index variable, and this reg we use for handling data transfer between one register to another register. At the time of doing further programming, there we will use frequently, you will understand in a better way. So these two are supported by every tool, but the question comes to use real or not. Time anyway is not supported to my knowledge, and the real time is also not supported. So the difference between time and the real time is you see here real numbers. In that way, it is like this number, like 3.5079 nanoseconds at that simulation time. So like that, real time simulations we can take. This time is like integer sort of, like at 1 nanosecond, at 2 nanosecond, what is the output, what is the happening really in simulation. So for that, this time real time is to have even that decimal points accuracy is more here. This real time, these are frequently used in simulation, that is in test benches. So now here is an example. Your examples, you see this reg cent, this is a user defined identifier. It is a scalar type. Since there is no size mentioned here, if there is a size mentioned, it would be like this. Reg, and the size of this SAT is 32 bit. In this 32 bit, this is 31 is a MSB and this is a LSB. So here one point we everyone should note this. That point is this one. I'll take this. Suppose, say, if I am writing here this wire, and here is my something size vector, size is pi colon 0, and I am giving here the name something A, B, C, and another here wire again. But this time I'm giving a 0:5. This is square bracket. Again, this is A, B, C, for example. Otherwise, let us take some different here. It's X, Y, Z, Z. So now, in this case, A, B, C, together it's a single identifier, because there is no gap here. ABC together we are writing without any space, so it is treated as a single identifier. And A, this is the phi, A of phi, this is MSB. Here in this case, this is a MSB, most significant bit. But in this case, X, Y, Z, phi is not MSB, it is LSB. So this is important while you are writing any of the code, your RTL code. You have to ensure this one. This is called little Indian something little E N D I A N, little Indian notation, where this you have this one. Value low value at LSB side here, LSB side, and high value at MSB side. So that is called little Indian, and this is called big Indian notation. So big, we have to be careful while writing addresses. If you are developing a code for microprocessor, and that microprocessor has got suppose say address of 16 bit. So the address is suppose a PC is somebody trying to join there. Again, I have to attend. See, this is another problem. So our program counter is having suppose say this is a reg. I'm writing a reg, and the size is 15:0. This is my program counter. So 16 bit PC is program counter. So at that time, we should be careful while we're assigning meaning what really we mean. Like if you're assigning a PC some address value here. So, and you are trying to access suppose a PC of 7:0, this address location you are trying to access, but you forgot that this here actually you might have mentioned here this way, that is 15 colon 0, but here while accessing, suppose 0 colon 7, you are accessing, thinking that this is my MSP somewhere. Somewhere MSP means here in this 15, downwards if you go 14, somewhere like here 0. Your intention is actually to access 7 to 0. In this sense, I'm telling that this is your MSP now. So your intention is actually to access the address this way, that starting this bit like that. But by mistake, you took this way. So you actually are reversing everything. So meaning that every thing you are messing up everything. So that's why a standard rule we have to follow. So most likely what I heard from the people, those who are working in the industry, they use this sort of thing. So because it is very obvious that higher value is there at the MSP and lower value is there for the LSP. So that's why they prefer this sort of thing, Little Indian or this sort of thing. So that's why you have to be very cautious about using this vector type. So this is where I was here. This vector type, I think that thing is clear, but still, if not clear, you don't go panic, will work about this. And coming to this integer, it's A, B, C, like that. Here, what if you have this is reg and the CNT and SAT? This is also one important point I forgot to discuss. Let's come to you. I have my reg single keyboard, and in this example here I have this one CNT and SAT. This CNT is a scalar type and this is a vector type, but what I thought is one keyword will do for CNT and SAT. So first I have put here the 31 and 0 and then SAT, and thinking that no problem with that, the other one is CNT. So like that, if I put, what happens is actually this SAT and CNT both are treated like this. So that is again another problem. Can we put this way? Means if we put CNT first here and then 30, yeah, someone trying to yes, anyone whether trying to communicate. Okay, by mistake they unmuted, I guess.
No, I am so, unable to see your presentation.
Unable to see presentation?
Yes.
Oh, I'm sorry. So let me go. Here is the problem. What had happened here is, resume your presentation. That is the thing I see here. This happened just because people in between, they came and joining, right? So I was coming from this, my presentation here, leaving this. Now I think you can see now. Can you see?
Yes, Jack. Now it's okay.
Yeah. I'm just clarifying why that glitch was. The glitch was because I'm leaving this presentation and coming and going here and seeing the people who are coming and admitting them. So during that time, this presentation you see here, you are presenting, this one has gone in a pause state. So this is another problem. People joining late, they also cause not only distraction and such glitches also, they are responsible, they are the reason for such glitches. So I request, that's why people joining lately, please. What you do is, if you cannot sit before the system, then you please just join and go anywhere. But you just join before 5 minutes and leave your device anywhere and go, and later on anytime you come and sit in before the device. So that way you will help me from all this sort of details. Okay, coming to the presentation. where I was till here, can whether you have you seen this one? This I was talking about people do this mistake. This is also a one more point I had to discuss. Like that, I said till here. Whether have you seen till here? I think Suresh, it was.
Yes, till here we can, no problem.
Till here you have seen, no?
Correct.
Okay. This one you couldn't able to see, this portion.
Correct.
Okay. So what I was telling here, while declaring using a single time keyword, we can actually declare reg and all scalar variables or identifiers here, separated with a comma. For example, you have A, B, and C, and then vector type variables, anything. Suppose say you have some vector here like that, so that is A1, and then like that you separate, better you separate vector type variables and this is scalar type variables and vector type variables. If you separately you declare. Otherwise, what you do is, if you don't take care like this, by mistake you may commit this mistake. What happens is, you actually intend cnt to be your scalar type and sant to be your vector type, but by mistake, since you used one single reg keyword and you are writing this way, compiler is going to treat this sat and this cnt both like a scalar type, and the size of the scalar is this 132. This is happening by mistake. So in order to avoid such mistake, you have to have this approach, all scalar with one keyword this way, all vector type with another. One more time you use the keyword and have all vector type declared there. Is that clear to everyone? Yes. Yeah. Thank you. So that way we can avoid human prone mistake, possible mistake that may happen here at this stage. So we can avoid that one. So let us proceed to another here. Now coming to the parameters. Parameter is a keyword here. This parameter is a keyword. So somewhere I am writing here. Suppose this is this one test bench or not? Somewhere I am. I have this here test bench. You see, everyone see here hash point. So I don't want to put here all the time or point. All the time I want to put some name, suppose say hash something, some name if I want. So here I can do here module, inside module here somewhere, parameter, and say delay and space point. So, and then use here delay. Whenever you thought of changing the delay, simply change this number here, parameter space the delay space pi is there. Instead of pi you put the 10, so automatically that will be applied everywhere the delay is. So that is where, that's how this this parameter is helping you actually. Parameter, very good. This parameter is helping you that way. Parameter delay, and the value you are putting is a point. So anyway, this delay is there, earlier shown delay, hash y, you put a delay, so that the value, whatever the value is, that value is taken by the compiler. So anytime in future course of time, if you want to test with some other delay, then change this numerical value automatically wherever this line length is there, everywhere that is applicable. So that way, we can have this parameter use. So likewise, now finally we come to this memories. So sometimes in our hardware description, we may have some memories also. Like in this case, if you see, we have 64 4-bit registers, meaning this my underscore mem 0 array, it is this 0, my underscore mem 0 is having this capacity of 4 bits it can hold. Likewise, how many arrays are there here? What is the size? 64. So every array has got the capacity to hold the this 4 bits. So that's how this memory is, if you are working with the RAM or ROM sort of things, then this approach is very, very handy. We have to remember how we, dimensions we declare. So reg is a keyword, and every how many arrays that we want, and what is the size of each array, that array, how many bits it can handle. So that is how we declare here. So if you see this example here, you have this reg 1:5. This is the identifier. But the other side here, right hand side, this mymem has got right hand side and left hand side. Right hand side is coming your array. But if you see this dig, there is nothing here. So meaning it's a simply dig, there is no array. Simply dig, and the dig capacity is to hold this 5 bits. And the MSB here is this one is MSB. Just don't have an impression that since it's a 5, so dig of 5 may be MSB. No, dig of 5 is a LSB. So that completes our memories, and the read mem, this we'll see it later on. Now, we are coming to this actual, we're entering into, various types of descriptions. These various types of descriptions are, you have switch level, gate level, data flow level, behavioral level, structural level. These are the various abstraction levels you can describe your hardware. The problem with switch level, the problem with gate level, the problem with data level, are evident in the name itself. Here you have to have the circuit knowledge. Switch level is possible. This is called switch level. Here you have the switches. You have your PMOS. You have your NMOS, and you know the circuit here in this fashion. Circuit is there, and then only you can describe your code. But you tell me. A complex circuit such as a 4-bit arithmetic logic unit you are going to design, forget about the processor, just a 4-bit arithmetic logic unit, how much complexity is involved. So how is that possible for a designer to know inside how many PMOSs are there, how many NMOSs are there, and what are the like this interconnection is. So meaning what with this, what I'm trying is this switch level, which is actually using this one, the switch level primitives are this. You have MOS transistor switches in the Verilog SDL language, NMOS, PMOS, CMOS, and RNMOS, resistive NMOS, resistive PMOS, resistive CMOS. So when these are the keywords, okay, keywords are there in the language, no problem. But what is the point of having them? The point of having them, if you know the circuit like this, then you can use. But in modern days, the complexity of billions of transistors, you don't know how many billions of transistors are there and the connectivity of these billion transistors in which fashion they are. So that way, this switch level fails there. Are you getting everybody there? What I'm telling you? Switch level fails there. But why we are studying them? Just to know that this language has got that ability to. This is for academic purpose. If you are learners now, so we can try how coding is done, like this learning. This is in, this is out, this is control, and this is how the connections are of the circuit, and this is how we describe and we perform the simulation. And we will be happy seeing that, oh, I gave the inverter something, and the inverted output is coming.
So that way we will be happy with that. But in industry point of view, if you see, switch level will not be used. 99% of switch level will not be used. 1% if small design is there, if it is workable or not instantly, if they know the circuit, then they can go for switch level. Is that clear to everyone, switch level? Everybody there?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, thank you. So similarly, coming to the gate level, if you see the gate level, we have the gate level here. These are the gate level primitives. We have AND gate, we have NAND gate, we have OR gate, all basic gates are fundamentally available here. But again, the question rises, what is the point of having them? What is the point? Because suppose, say, again, the same story. If I'm going for a 4-bit arithmetic logic unit, you know very well arithmetic logic unit, arithmetic components are there. That is, adder is there, subtractor is there, multiplier is there, division, whatnot. All arithmetic components are there in that, hardware is there. So that hardware, how many AND gates it takes, how many NAND gates it takes, how many flip-flops it takes, there is no information. If there would have been any information, then what is the point of having the language itself? So that is what I'm trying hard to convey you, that these gate level primitives are there. Again, we are happy doing something, some sort of this, see, to verify truth table and waveforms of logic gates using gate level model. This gate level model, we are writing some code here, something. We are happy here writing a NAND, instantiating a NAND keyword, and AND keyword, NOT keyword, and then NOR keyword, and then NOR keyword, and the XOR keyword, and XNOR keyword, like that, using them. And these are the instantiation names here. You see inverter, AND one, NAND one, and then inside these inputs and outputs, we are identifiers, we are putting them. And this is done, the basic code is done, and we write some test bench, and we provide some inputs, V in 1 and V in 2, and this input is given to all gates. So this is all gates is my module here. So all gates, and this all gates, once it is simulated, this will give for various, depending upon this inverter output, AND output, NAND output, OR output, NOR output. So it will give some outputs, and we're seeing them, we will be happy. Array, yeah, I did some program. But what is the point of having? Again, you think, so this gate level is useful only when we know the gates. So, I mean, the hardware that is required by the circuit itself. So there were, again, gate level industry, 99% this gate level modeling. Industry will not use, company fellows will not use this. Company fellows will not use this one. Company fellows will not use this. I am telling you, 99% they will not use. 1% I am leaving, just because some small tiny designs are there handy, then they will immediately put in a gate level and they ensure that that design is working. That's why that 1% I am leaving there. Now coming to the data flow level modeling. In this data flow level modeling, again, we have to know all this, what we call this, whether I developed that, yes. So in this data flow level modeling, so all these arithmetic operators and functionality, what is really happening, depending upon that, I can pick all this and I can make use of these operators, I can build the circuit. But again, the question is, what is the point of having that? Because it means what? I must know the circuit. So if I know the circuit, then why should I go for the Verilog HDL learning? I don't know the circuit, and synthesizer tool should give me the circuit. So I am writing English like language, and burden is upon the synthesizer tool. Synthesizer tool will be giving me the hardware. That is the main intention of switching from manual approach to the CAD approach, computer-aided design approach, and we EC people, electronics people, call it as a electronic design automation. So that's why what I conclude today in this wrap-up session. From tomorrow onwards, we'll see the in detail again all this. The company will not use 99% switch level. For us as a learners, we have to know that the ability of the language is we can model our hardware using this. Such MOS transistor keywords also. Again, keep in mind that we have to know the circuit beforehand. Gate level also the same. gate level keywords are provided by the this language, Verilog language. Again, we have to know what are the gates required to build the hardware itself, and the interconnections also we must know. Then only it is possible for us to build a hardware such as like this. Suppose say you have this half adder, so you are using this in this half adder assign. You know, you must know what is to be done here. This is I have to do this XOR operation, and then AND operation to get the carry, to get the sum. I have to do XOR. That way, if you know, then you can use this data flow level modeling or gate level modeling or switch level. So that's why what I am concluding today is industry 99% it will not be using this first one. Second one also it will not use 99%. Industry 100% it will be using 10% behavioral level model. This one we'll see what behavioral level modeling later on. We'll do a lot more experiments, and our final project also will be depending upon this only. So, and in this behavioral level, some of the data flow level operators will make use here. Entire coding is not done in the data flow level alone. Wherever required, some small portions will use in data flow, because some operators we have to use such operators. These operators we have to know, must know. So with this I conclude today's session. I think I conveyed to you people today's task. So see, people are joining. Vinusha is joining now. We are wrapping the session now. She has joined. So any questions, are there any questions so that I can take the questions now, because we stop this.